I want to say good morning, because what that song is all about, He Lives, is the reason we are here today. There was a moment in history 2,000 years ago where the Roman political machinery and the religious leadership of the Jewish nation thought they had quieted the voice and the message of Jesus Christ. They crucified Him and they buried Him, only to discover death could not hold Him. And so hundreds of thousands of churches around the world today are meeting and doing this very same thing. And not picking on anybody here, but there are some of you are here today simply because it's Easter. And I say thank you. I say thank you. I tell our church, if there's one Sunday out of a year you shouldn't miss, it is far more important than Christmas. Far more important than Christmas. Because if Easter had not have happened, the Christmas message would have been finished. It would have been over. And so this is a very special day because He lives. So I am glad you are here. And I'm saying good morning to our crowd over in the other building, all right? Not everybody could fit in here, and so there's some folks over in the overflow. So thank you for going over there, and we hope you enjoy it as much as we are going to enjoy it in here. And I know there are some of you who are standing, and there are some individual seats right over on this side. How many do we have? Three or four? There's four right over on that side. So if you need, there's room for two right there. We got room for a couple. We got room for three up here. All right. So while I'm taking just a couple of minutes here to get things squared away, don't be embarrassed to go find a seat. All right. Let me highlight a few things. It's already been a grand week. All right. Connected with New Hope and the Easter week. Last Saturday, we sent 42 high schoolers and junior highs with about 18 adults to Mexico. And they all came back yesterday. Not one was left behind. All right? Not one. And so we are very, very excited about that. That's kind of a picture of just one event, as you know. In a week or two, we'll have some more up there. And then they'll have a special evening event to highlight everything that was done in Mexico. But everybody came back saying it was absolutely fantastic. And so we're grateful for that. On Friday, there were about 8 to 10 from New Hope Church who participated with Prison Fellowship in a Good Friday service in Folsom Prison. I had never been in Folsom Prison before in my life, all right? And I got a chance to go there. And I tell you, I was awed, one, by the place, number two, by what happened there. I can tell you that at least on the men's side of the two services, I'm not sure what happened on the ladies' side, but about 50 men made public decisions to stand up and say, I'm now a believer in Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. And that was absolutely incredible. I got a chance to tell them that, you know, Johnny Cash made Folsom Prison famous, but Tim Kepler made it real to us at New Hope, all right? He's one of our worship leaders. He's over in Japan doing ministry, but he spent some time in Folsom Prison. We've got some other men in our church who spent some time in Folsom Prison, and it was pointed out to me. Hey, Fred was there and there, and hey, Tim was there, and so and so was over here, and some of you are saying, I would hate to be in Folsom Prison, but if it takes Folsom Prison to get you to find Jesus Christ, would you hate it? No, you would not. All right. It was a life-changing moment for them, and they've been set free in Folsom Prison by knowing the risen Christ, and over time, they were set free, and now they're part of New Hope Church, and we rejoice over that fact. And so it was a great day in Folsom Prison. It was built in 1880. These are the big stones, all right, granite stones that make the walls of these buildings. The chapel was built in 1905. And one of their residents in 1930 painted a mural of the Last Supper on the whole back wall, okay? And do you know whose faces he put on the disciples? His new buddies in prison, in Folsom Prison. Those are the faces that are there. He painted many other murals. The time and decay has eroded them off the walls, and that one's in very bad shape. He worked in Hollywood. He was a set designer until he committed manslaughter. And then he ended up in Folsom Prison. And he continued to use his talents. And one of them was to give testimony to Jesus Christ. Fred, look, there's two seats right up here. Come on down. Come on down, Fred. All right. So let me highlight a few prayer requests. One other announcement, and then we'll do prayer requests. Next Sunday is going to be another great Sunday for us here at New Hope. We have about 20 people to baptize next Sunday morning in our 9:15 and our 10:45 service. Other men and women and young people who have discovered the risen life of Jesus Christ and the difference that it makes in them. So we're glad that you're here today. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. If you are a guest, we are honored to have you here. We make promises. If you give us this information, we are not going to sell it to the IRS, or we're not going to sell it to Google. But also on top of that, we are not going to come knock on your door, and we're not going to call you on the phone. But through the mail, we're going to send to you information that tells you about the church, what we believe, who our staff is, ways that you can get engaged if you ever desire to do so. And so we'd love to get that information in your hands. If you choose just not to fill out a card, that's okay, but you want that information, you can go out there in the pavilion after the service is over, and you'll see a guest card there, and you'll find a brochure in there that will give you most of those answers, all right? So thank you so very much for being here today. A couple of prayer requests. Jerry Brown is on a plane right now to Seattle, Washington. As you know, Jerry's a guy in our church who's got 16 stents in his heart. 6 weeks ago, we had a very unique procedure that was done. It's only done in three places in the U.S. They were able to get part of the procedure accomplished. He had to recover. 6 weeks later, he's going back up today. They will do that second part of the procedure tomorrow. So please be praying for them. Lindsay Keene. Girl I baptized when she was about in the sixth grade. She's now in her late 20s, and tomorrow she has to go in and have a double mastectomy at Clovis Community Hospital. So we'll be praying for Lindsay. Carol Gill had some more cancer surgery on her face. She's recovering at home now and doing well in that area. The bad news is they discovered there is more cancer. So they'll find out more about that this coming week. Sue Williams, that is Pat Williams' daughter-in-law from our church. She has been through breast cancer treatment and some surgeries, and she's now having some infections as a result of those follow-up surgeries. So please remember to pray for Sue. So those are just a few of the folks that we want you to remember to pray for. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Gentlemen, if you would you join with me as we pray? And as soon as our offering is concluded, our Easter choir is going to knock your socks off this morning, all right? So would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, we love you. We thank you so much for what this season means. Quite frankly, Father, we know that if it wasn't for the reality of what this day represents, we would never be meeting on Sunday mornings for church. The reason we meet on Sunday mornings is because it gives testimony to the first day of the week, which the Scripture tells us that is the day that Jesus rose from the dead. So every single Sunday is a tribute to the resurrection, but this Sunday is the day in which it happened. And so we say thank you. Thank you for the incredible gift of your Son. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. Father, thank you for that great gift. And I pray that just as in our last service, there will be some in this service who before it's over will become members of your family. They will pray that prayer so they will not perish, but have everlasting life. Thank you that this is a day about life. Life is the only antidote I know for death. It's the only thing that overcomes it. And your Son did that 2,000 years ago, so we can do it today. We say thank you. We trust you with the needs that have been expressed here, and plus so many more, which we carried into this place in our heart. Thank you that we can trust you with each and every one of them. You know intimately about them. And Father, most of all, however you want to use us to be engaged in showing your care, your compassion, your love, your truth, may you find us available and willing to do so. For the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thanks. We commit all this to you in the awesome name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Because I've had the opportunity over the years to do a lot of hospice work, I've had the opportunity to sit at bedsides with friends, with family, with new friends that I met just in the closing weeks of their life. And on several of those occasions, I've had the opportunity of being there to hear their very last words. And you never know what you're going to hear. In fact, I don't know if any of you have ever thought to do this, but Google sometimes last words. There's a book written about last words. There are websites about last words. Last words are normally never forgotten by those who hear them. Sometimes they're poignant, sometimes funny, sad, some of them downright weird, on occasion mean. But last words can make quite an impact as we shuffle off the stage of life. Let me share just a few of them before I get to the most important one. Many of you in here probably remember the name P.T. Barnum. Barnum and Bailey Circus, all right? Yeah, circus, as I understand. The next generation will not even know what one is, all right? Ringley Brothers is shutting down, I understand, this year. P.T. Barnum died, and I understand his last words were these. How were the receipts today at Madison Square Garden? Humphrey Bogart. You guys have no idea who Humphrey Bogart is, do you? All right, and yeah, you have no idea. That row right there, you have no idea. He was a famous actor, all right? Yeah, classic, a lot of the classics. And Humphrey Bogart's last words were, I should have never switched from scotch to martinis. Now, remember I told you some of them were weird, okay? So this is my get-out-of-jail card before I quote this one, okay? Her name was Louise Marie Teresa de Saint Maurice, obviously French. She was the Contessa of a community in Italy, and she passed gas on her deathbed. And then she said, good, a woman who can fart is not dead. I don't know that that's ever made a sermon before, all right? But I can... I took it out, I put it in, I took it out, I put it in, and I just said, I gotta rip. All right, I couldn't pass it up. Oh, Joan Crawford, another actress from a previous generation, was filled with anger when her maid began to pray out loud for her. And Joan Crawford said, don't you dare ask God to help me. I would have hated to have been with her on her next breath. Bo Diddley. Bo Diddley died giving a thumbs up as he listened to a song entitled Walk Around Heaven. And his last word, wow. Leonardo da Vinci. All right, let that one settle in, all right? You do know Leonardo da Vinci, right? Okay, all right. They're still teaching him a little bit in school. Okay, good. Leonardo da Vinci, when surveying his life on his deathbed, said, I have offended God and mankind because my work did not reach the quality that it should. The Mona Lisa wasn't good enough. Wow. Pancho Villa, the Mexican revolutionary, cried, don't let it end like this! I got a feeling lots of folks have probably said that. Karl Marx, he turned to his housekeeper, who had urged him to tell her his last words so she could write them down, and he shouted, go on, get out! Last words are for fools who haven't said enough. Trust me, Karl Marx had said too much. Blues singer Bessie Smith died saying, I'm going, but I'm going in the name of Jesus. My mama's last word, beautiful, beautiful. The last words that I remember directed at me from my mother. I think I shared it not long ago here. It was at her bedside. It was Friday morning. I did not want to leave. I knew it was going to be her last day. And I had two funerals to preach. And I was cutting it close and leaving. And I said, Mama, I don't want to go. She grabbed my cheeks and she pulled me close and she said, son, you go give people hope who might not have any. We got more than enough. And so what I want to do today is I want to obey my mother's last command. I want to share hope to some of you who may have arrived without any hope. I want to share hope to some of you who you think your hope has been exhausted. I want to share hope to those who are simply just tired. You see, the shout from the cross comes from one whose every action was filled with meaning and purpose. Not only do we have the teaching of Jesus in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John of what happened when Jesus lived, but we also have his final thoughts. If you want to turn, I'll be referring to several verses in Luke chapter 23. Not only do we have the teaching of Jesus while we live, but we have his final thoughts while he hung on a cross, suspended between two thieves. The wrenching words of Jesus ushered forth from his lips while his sacrificial blood flowed down a cross and it splashed out onto the ground. While his body is in excruciating pain, his tongue is tormented because of thirst. Jesus cries out from those who have parched lips. And here is what Jesus says from the cross. Father, and I'm sure if he could have, Jesus would have done this. But he couldn't. And so Jesus bowed his head and he said these words, Father, forgive them, for they do not know, they do not understand what they are doing. You'll find that in verse 34 of Luke chapter 23. I want us to take a brief look at Jesus' last hours. You see, following the Last Supper, that's where Jesus had gathered the 12 disciples in an upper room. He had washed their feet. He had instituted a new ordinance called communion. And then he took a couple of his best buds out into the Garden of Gethsemane and said, hey, fellas, Peter, James, and John, he said, hey, I want you guys to pray with me. I'm going to face my most challenging day in life tomorrow. The most challenging day of my life is going to be the day of my death. I want you guys to hang with me for a little bit and pray. The scripture says Jesus separated a little ways from his buddies and he began to pray. He poured out his distress to his heavenly Father as he went through his deep personal spiritual struggle. Luke 22:44 says, and Jesus, being in anguish, prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. And an angel appeared at this point and gave Jesus strength. Just minutes after that prayer, Jesus was arrested, and he faced a trial sometime after midnight. He was led away with his hands bound. The same hands that just days before had healed the sick are now bound. Luke 22:63 tells us that Jesus was blindfolded and he was beaten on every side while soldiers mocked him. And then he faced a second trial with more illegal proceedings. Jesus is now exhausted. He's had a lack of sleep. He's been abused. He has a loss of fluids and he's put up with shame and ridicule. Pilate, the Roman ruler at the time in that region, has Jesus scourged. Roman law allowed a prisoner to be beaten just to the point of death. These whips that Jesus had been beaten with had fragments of metal, rock, and bone in them, and they would tear away at bone and tissue as they pulled him across his back. His skin would be stripped into long, ribbon-like segments, causing profound arterial bleeding. A crown of 6-inch thorns, if you can see that crown up there, those are probably only about 4 inches, so imagine 2 inches longer than that. And that crown was pressed into his scalp, which would produce additional blood loss. It would deepen his state of shock. A purple robe after the crown was put on, his head was then thrown across his shoulders and back, and I can just imagine that robe sticking to the blood in his back. And the mockery continues by soldiers as they spit on him. They beat him with reeds and they hail him, King of the Jews. Pilate then presents Jesus to a crowd wearing this crown of thorns and this purple robe. And he said, here's your man. Pilate then gives in to the pressure of the Jewish leaders and Jesus is condemned to death by crucifixion. The purple robe is now stripped away and he's naked. He's given a crossbeam to bear across his shoulders, and he's told to carry it to the place of the skull. It's called Golgotha's Hill. Luke 23, 33 says, when they came to the place called the skull, they crucified him along with criminals, one on his right and another on his left. I want you to listen to how Ray Pritchard, an author, writes in a book called In the Shadow of the Cross, how he captures the intensity of a moment when he writes from the perspective of those who were in charge of the crucifixion. Here's what he wrote. Jesus, now walking, now crawling, each step an agony to watch. He's been beaten within an inch of his life. His back is in shreds. His face is disfigured and puffy, where they've ripped out the beard by the roots. On his head is a crown of thorns. The soldiers don't mind getting a prisoner like this who's almost dead. It means their job is easier. They drive construction-grade spikes into both wrists and another one just above his ankles. With ropes in place, they begin to pull the cross up, smash it into place. Blood now spurts from the raw wounds of Jesus everywhere. Jesus no doubt experienced severe muscular pain in the upper extremities that only got worse as his joints began to separate and be pulled apart. He could draw air into his lungs, but he could not exhale. And as carbon dioxide accumulated, progressive degrees of asphyxiation would occur. They would build up lactic acid that would create violent muscle spasms throughout his body. And in order to take a breath, Jesus would have to push up on that spike in his legs, force himself up so he could exhale. I don't know if any of you have had the opportunity yet to go see the movie just released. Our small group went last Tuesday night, called The Case for Christ. It is the story of Lee Strobel, who wrote the book, Case for Christ. Lee Strobel was a writer for the Chicago Tribune. He was an atheist. He was very picky about the girls he dated in college. They kind of had to fill out a form. Do you believe in God? Yes. Not you. Do you believe in God? No. Okay, maybe. He only wanted to date atheists. They got married. He got his job at Chicago Tribune. He got promoted. His wife got invited to church when he was out of town. She goes to church one time and gets saved. Ticks him off. No problem. He's smart. He's a writer. He'll do the research. He'll prepare a paper. He'll give that paper to his wife. It'll convince her that she made a mistake and their life will get back to normal. He went to some of the brightest minds he could find, trying to get material to disprove Jesus Christ. He flew all the way from Chicago out to Los Angeles to meet with a doctor because he thought, okay, the resurrection couldn't have occurred if Jesus had not died. So what Jesus did on the cross is he just passed out. And then after laying on a hard rock in a tomb, 3 days later, he got up and walked away. Now, the problem with that is there's still a big stone over the door that takes several men to put it in place. There's a centurion guard out front whose responsibility is to make sure nobody stole the body, much less walk away, because if it got out, they would lose their life. But he was desperate. So he flies, meets a doctor, and the doctor explains to him everything I've just kind of described to you about what happened in crucifixion, plus the fact that they stuck a spear in his side and water came out along with blood, and that's only possible after you're dead. And he said, you mean, doc, there's no medical way that he could have just passed out? This guy goes into a file, pulls out an edition of the American Medical Journal, and he says, here's an article written by several doctors that tell you Jesus died. And that became the linchpin that was pulled in his belief system that eventually brought Lee Strobel to a place to where he gave his life to Jesus Christ. Listen to Peter's perspective on how Jesus responded in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 23, when Peter said these words, when they hurled their insults at Christ, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to his Father who justifies completely. Jesus could have prayed, Father, wipe them out. We used to sing a song when I grew up in church, not much older than these kids on the front row. We used to sing a song in church. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world, but he died alone for you and me. That's what he did. Let's look for just a couple of minutes at the first words of the last words on the cross. The first words of the last words that Jesus ever would utter were those words, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." And the rest of that verse says, "And they divided up his clothes by casting lots." At the foot of the cross, while Jesus was praying, guards were gambling for his clothing. When the first red drops of blood spurted on his hands and splashed on the soldier's hammer, the blessed mouth of Jesus formed the words of a prayer for all of our pardons. His request was not to get himself out of that difficulty. Isn't that how we usually pray? God, could you get me out of the jam? That was not Jesus' prayer. Jesus' prayer was for those who put him in that jam. He extended not justice to them, but mercy. This verse is in the imperfect tense, and I don't mean to bore you with an English lesson or a language lesson, but the imperfect tense means this: that is not a prayer that Jesus prayed just once. It means he did it again and again and again. As often as necessary, Jesus prayed that prayer. When the nails tore through his tendons, sending pain throughout his body, he closed his eyes and he said, "Father, forgive them." When the cross was dropped in place by the guards between two criminals, he cried out, "Father, forgive them." When they divided up his earthly possessions and gambled for them, Jesus said, "Father, forgive them." As the rulers sneered at him and mocked him, Jesus looked at them and said, "Father, they don't understand what they're doing. Forgive them." When the sign, "This is King of the Jews," was hammered above his head, he whispered, "Father, forgive them." But do you know that when you lied, Jesus was saying, "Father, forgive them"? Do you realize when you cheated on your tax returns, that was just day before you? Oh, no, actually, you get till tomorrow, don't you? It's not too late to correct it. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them." When we said nothing when something was important to be said, when hatred controlled our speech and our decisions, when alcohol manipulated us and drugs mastered you, when you abused your spouse and abandoned your baby, do you know that it was Jesus standing before the Father praying, "Father, forgive them. They do not understand what they're doing"? And the reason I know that Jesus is still doing that to this day is because the book of Hebrews chapter 7 verse 25 says, "He always lives. The one they crucified and buried, who rose again from the dead," Hebrews says, "He always lives to make intercession for us." He's praying for our forgiveness at this very moment. Jesus' cry from the cross reveals five important facts. First of all, prophecy was fulfilled. If we had the opportunity today, and I would encourage you sometime in the next few days, go read the 12 verses of Isaiah chapter 53, just 12 verses. In those 12 verses, there are 10 prophecies written 700 years before the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, all fulfilled in these last few days of Jesus' life on earth. Verse 3 says that Jesus would be despised and rejected by men. Was he? Yeah. It says he would be a man of sorrows, familiar with suffering. Was he? Yeah. It said he would be afflicted by God because of our sin. Was he? Yeah. It said he would be pierced by our transgressions. Was he? It says he would be wounded and bruised by men. Was he? It says he would be led like a lamb to a slaughter, silent before his accusers. Was he? Yeah. It says he would be buried in a rich man's tomb. Was he? Yes. It says he would be the guilt offering to God for all of our sin. Was he? It said he would be numbered with the transgressors, hung between common criminals. Was he? And last of all, in verse 12, it says he would pray for those who were transgressors. Did he? Yeah. 10 700-year-old prophecies, all fulfilled in the life of one man in a matter of days. Jesus' cry also reveals the blindness of our human heart. Jesus recognized that those who crucified him, those who have sinned against him, didn't understand what they were doing. We don't, do we? While his enemies knew full well what they meant when they said, "Crucify him," they were ignorant of the enormity of their crime. They did not know that they were killing the Lord of glory, and while they didn't know, they should have known. And what they didn't know that they should have known, you should know. You should know. You came here on an Easter Sunday morning. Some of you, you were drug here. I understand that. You were bribed. You want Easter eggs later? Go to church with me, all right? You want lunch? Go to church with me, all right? I'm singing in the choir. You ever want another Christmas gift? Come hear me sing. I know all of that. But what we so quickly want to dump on Roman centurions and Jewish Pharisees, we have to own our own responsibility, folks. For 2,000 years, millions and millions of churches have sung the song, "He Lives." And preachers have preached the sermon, "He Lives." And we have shared with you the fact that Jesus comes to change not only our destination, but he comes to change our destiny. We have no excuse. The third thing these last words of the cross do is they reveal to us the magnitude of our need. Because our hearts are blind, our need is great. We're sinners in need of forgiveness. It's not just those who were involved in the crucifixion. In a very real sense, we all are responsible for his execution. Most of us have no problem putting blame on others as an excuse for their poor behavior. But we must understand Jeremiah 17:9, a verse that New Hope's been getting very familiar with over the last month here at New Hope, is the hardest deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it? We want to believe that other people need Jesus, but I don't. Other people may be sinners, but I'm not. I'm a good person. God's going to let me into heaven when I die just because I'm good. Gooder than who? How you like that for an English lesson? You probably don't say that on TV, do you? Yeah. Better than who? Not as bad as who? Whom? During the Second World War, an old cathedral was bombed in England by the Germans. In the 1960s, a new cathedral was built alongside the ruin of the old one. On the altar, there is a cross that was constructed out of wood and nails that were taken from the collapsed roof of the old church. On the cross are these words, "Father, forgive." Many English visitors were bothered by this because they wanted it to say, "Father, forgive them." Meaning, "Father, forgive the Germans for bombing this beautiful place of worship." The reason it reads like it does is because that pastor of that congregation, even where the issue seemed to be so clear-cut, he knew that Britain had sins of their own to confess. He knew that Romans 3:23 read, "For all have sinned, Germans and Brits alike, and fallen short," and may I say, Americans. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. The last words of Jesus Christ on the cross are an identification of who he was. At that moment, Jesus realized there was a transition in his life about to take place. You see, up to then, Jesus had gone along during his ministry forgiving the sins of other people. To one young man, he said, "Go and sin no more." To another young man, he said, "Your sins have been forgiven." To a woman at the well, "Your sins are forgiven." Why all of a sudden does Jesus now turn to his Father and say, "Father, forgive them"? Why didn't he just forgive them? See, Jesus knew what was about to happen. Jesus knew that he who knew no sin was about to become sin so that every one of us who were sinners could now have the righteousness of God. Jesus knew that a great exchange was about to take place. Jesus knew that he was going to exchange his sinless perfection for all of our sinful ugliness. And he knew that he had to do that in order that you and I could exchange all of our sinful ugliness for all of his perfect righteousness. I don't know about you folks, but that's a pretty dang good deal. My crap for his glory. Do you understand? I don't care how good you have been on. I hate it. Leonardo da Vinci. I would say Leonardo da Vinci was not an underachiever in life. That's my evaluation of Leonardo da Vinci. And yet, was da Vinci comparing himself with other people? No. Da Vinci, in his last words, was saying, "God, I think I could have done so much more for you. I think I could have let you have done so much more in my life." You see, we don't compare ourselves with each other to determine if we are sinners or not. We compare ourselves to God. That's why Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of what?" Yeah, not an American standard. Okay, not a cultural standard, not an educational standard, not a moral standard. You simply have fallen short of the magnificence of who God is. Let me wrap this up. The fifth thing that the last words of Jesus on the cross reveal to us is the triumph of divine love. When man had done his worst, when the vileness of the human heart was displayed in all of its ugliness, when the creature executed the Creator, divine love triumphed and said, "Father, forgive them. They have no clue to what they're doing." That prayer was answered immediately in one sense when the centurion at the foot of the cross, you can go read this in verse 47 of Luke 23, the centurion at the foot of the cross put his faith in Jesus Christ. He said, "Surely this must be a righteous man." The prayer was answered in a profound way on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, verse 41, when we read that 3,000 were saved at the first public preaching after the resurrection of Jesus. This prayer also was answered in a very personal way on the third Thursday of June of 1960 at Hume Lane Camp, when a 5-year-old boy by the name of Tim McLean Rowland invited Jesus Christ to come live into his life. And this prayer can be answered in a memorable way by you today if you've never prayed it. You see, the choir had their turn. I have now had my opportunity. It's now your move. Have you been forgiven? If Jesus can forgive those responsible for doing that to him, he can forgive you. There may be someone here today who does not have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Oh, you've been through religious rituals, but you've never invited Christ into your life. I'm not asking you today to become a Baptist or a Presbyterian or a Lutheran or a Catholic or a Mormon or a Muslim. Religion is a bane to a relationship with Jesus Christ. I'm asking you this. Have you recognized that you've fallen short of God's glory? That Jesus offers to you forgiveness? And you, through repentance means I'm ready to make an about face. I got a new friend. His name is Transparent. Dwight something senior, but his musical name is Transparent. He's about a 6'2" black guy. He's in his early 30s, and he sings gospel rap. I tried rap one time here. You remember that a few years ago? Yeah, I rap like a white boy, all right? Wasn't very good. This guy was real. Transparent was really, really, really good. And one of his songs that he rapped was called 180. He said, "There was a time in my life I made a 180. Some of you might need to make a 180 today and stop being self-reliant and start being Christ-reliant. You see, you can have your sins forgiven. The Bible says you can become white as snow. You can have the power of Jesus living in you every single day. It's what Paul wrote when he said, "The mystery of God has been revealed, Christ in you, the hope of glory." You can have the hope of eternal destiny. Jesus said to a thief on the cross today, one thief cursed God. The other thief said, "You've done nothing wrong. Remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said, "Today you'll be with me in a prepared place." Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday 2017 could become your spiritual birthday. We can become a delivery hospital right here for you. It's very simple. Acknowledge you are a sinner. 2, believe that Jesus died for your sin and that he rose again to come live his life within you. And 3, confess. You see, the difference between saying wow and beautiful as your final words rather than get out of here, don't pray for me, the difference is knowing Christ. Some have said, Tim, I don't know if I can, how will I know I've been forgiven? The one who tells us about Jesus, this same book, also tells us that we can know when we have put our faith in Jesus Christ, when we understand the finished work that Jesus has done for us, when we pray, God hears. I can tell you in the last service, 5 people walked out of here who didn't know that now know that they are a child of God. Not a Baptist, not a member of New Hope Church, but somebody who has a relationship with Jesus Christ. And when we know that, we can sing as Steve Brown did on this stage earlier, God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and he died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. And because he lives, I can face tomorrow. I don't know what's on your calendar tomorrow. I know what it is for Jerry Brown. He's going under a knife. I know what it is for Lindsay Keen. She's going under the knife. I know what it is for a few others recovering from surgeries. I don't know what you're going through, but I know because he lives, we can face tomorrow. I know because he lives. That's why Jerry Brown said to me at 7:05, I said, Jerry, I'm sorry I can't be there on this trip. He said, well, Easter morning's a little bit more important than my surgery. I said, well, I don't know if it's more important, but yeah, it probably is. And he said, but Tim, you were there last time, and God will still be there with me this time. I am not afraid because I know he holds the future. There's not a one of us who needs to be afraid to die. It's just simply the door to a far grander life than we could ever imagine. And life is worth the living just because he lives. Would you bow your heads with me for just a moment? In Folsom Prison, when the invitation was given, Jane Johnson drew a line in the dirt and he asked men to step from their cluster of gang members, to step from their familiar place on the yard if they wanted a new life in Jesus Christ, to come stand at this line and begin to pray with them. It was pretty bold. And men came out. They left their gangs. They left their cluster. And they came and stood and said, I want to be identified not by the people I run around with, but I want to be identified by the one who gave his life for me. And there was one of the guys there, big. He was the biggest guy on the yard that I saw, a big black guy. And he got up there, and he had a big smile on his face. And he turned around, and he faced the crowd, and he just started pointing at some of his boys. He said, you need to get up here. You come on up. And he just called them forth. I'm not going to be quite that brass with you today. But I'm going to ask you, if you've never invited Jesus Christ, you've gone to church, you may think you're a good person, but you've never, ever actually said, wow, I've fallen short of the glory of God. I'm a sinner. Jesus died on a cross for me and rose again for the dead for me, and I've never invited him to come live within my life. Jesus is knocking. It's what the Bible says. He knocks. He never breaks it down. He never forces his way in. He doesn't sneak in. He knocks at the door and says, will you let me in? And are you ready to let him in today? If so, follow along in your own mind and heart a simple prayer that I'll pray. If you're here today and maybe years ago you invited Christ in your life, but you have been living and acting as if he doesn't count, you haven't considered him in any decisions that you're making, any direction that you're taking, and you realize you need to get back on track, then why don't you also join us in this prayer? Say something like this in your own mind and heart. Father, I was just coming to church today for free lunch. I was just coming to church today, Father, because it's what was expected. But Father, I've run into the unexpected. I've run into you. I've really tried to avoid you for much of my life, but today I realize I can't avoid you anymore. I'm accountable for the decisions that I make, and this is the most the most important decision that I could ever make, and that is, I want you in my life. I admit I've fallen short. I admit that I am a sinner. I like to do things my own way. I like to be the God of my own life. But today, I want to turn the reins of my life over to you. I want to invite you to come in, be my Savior, Lord, and life. I don't understand what all that's going to mean in the future, but I know I want to begin that journey today. God, I made a commitment to you years ago, but I've divorced you. I've run from you. I've abandoned you. Today, I've been reminded of what I've left. I'm coming home. Dear Father, thank you for hearing these prayers. Just for a brief moment left. Still praying. If you prayed that prayer today, you really said, okay, it's time I stop playing games. I really am going to invite Christ to be my Savior, Lord, and life. And I just did that to him in that prayer. Would you just quietly put your hand up and down? I'm not going to come to you. I'm not going to call you out. I'm not going to have you cross a line today. But I just want to give God thanks. All right, I see one. Anybody else? You say, yeah, I'm choosing to invite Christ in my life. Amen. There's two. Anybody else? You can put your hand down. Amen. Thank you. Three. Thank you. You're making the most important decision in your life when you make this decision to invite Jesus Christ in your life. It doesn't make you a weak man. It'll make you the strongest man you've ever been. It doesn't make you unwise. This will make you the wisest person that you've ever been. This will make you the most prepared. Will it shatter your plans? Yes, it will. But God has a better plan. He has a better. Anyone else? Before I close with a prayer of thanks, Tim, I've made the decision today to be a Christian. Our Father in heaven, thank you for these two in this service who said yes to Jesus Christ. I pray that over the next few days or weeks that they'll reach out to us here at the church office, or if they're not from here, Father, they'll contact a good friend or family member who walks with you, and we can put in their hands what will be some good things for their next steps in their relationship with Jesus Christ. You love us so much. And Father, I remember when somebody said to me the other day, or actually it was Tim, had a chance to share with his nephew, and one of the things that Shelley shared with him that would be maybe a good way to enter a discussion with somebody that we're unsure if they don't know you, who's dying, is, hey, I can't stand the thought of spending eternity in heaven without you there. So, Father, thank you for those who made heaven a sure thing for them today. Easter Sunday 2017 is now their spiritual birthday. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.